Thanks.
Well, it was really interesting to hear what Sal, Mike, and Andres have to say. And actually, during this afternoon, we've been listening a lot about how to deliver more digital. And two things, many of you are every day trying to deliver to deliver digital solutions. So pushing delivery, digital solutions into a market is the core of many of our businesses. However, we now know that these consumers have become increasingly more and more demanding. Now, when you go out there to the market, you will be facing a lot of competition from a number of different other providers. So consumers are in the middle of a sea of abundance of options. Every time that someone downloads an application into their mobile device, it's not choosing one in a million. They are choosing one in 2 million. So the amount of choices that consumers have is increasing the complexity of how you reach them. So we've been paying a lot of attention to that. How do we deliver? How do we create a wonderful application? Today Martin earlier said, it's no longer just about one app. In the year 2000, everyone had to have a website. In 2010, everyone had to have a mobile app. And the reality is that many people didn't understand why you needed it, but you knew that you needed to have it. What we're seeing now, and what Martin explained as the digital journey, is that experiences are much longer. Experiences are not particularly about the touch point, but mostly about how a consumer perceives this. And the problem is that when you're trying to deliver these kind of solutions, as Sal was explaining, you cannot conceive a company that delivers digital solutions without having employees who are engaged. And it's at the intersection of the satisfaction of the consumer and the employees of the company who deliver that solution, where magical things happen. So that brings me to speak today about the concept of how the corporate environment has become more digital. And I will also argue that typical conceptions about enterprise consumerization typically fall short of what they need to be. Why? Essentially, we have come up to realize that the consumerization of the enterprise is something that, we need to accept it. Our security officer, the CIO, hey, these guys are bringing me an iPhone when I have BlackBerries, or BlackBerries not now, but essentially, we have seen consumers, people, employees, that in their private lives became a consumer, suddenly coming to the workplace, trying to push for either their own devices or either a friendlier application. But I believe that there is much more than that. And I will tell you today what I like. I started to fish a couple of years ago. And I have had days in which I go fishing and I throw the line, and nothing happens in the entire day. After a couple of hours there, I know that there will hardly be a trout in the water. But there are some other times in which I go and I throw, and suddenly I get a trout. And I love those days. Because it's like you have those eureka moments when you found something that is different. So I want to tell you about that. I will start by telling a little bit about what consumers typically want. We have become like androids. We are partly humans, partly technology empowered. we have come up to do things that in the 70s, you know, when I was a kid, it would have been something like coming from the $6 million, you know. Yes, now we can go in the restaurant and we know that it's good. We can connect to friends that are 3,000 kilometers from us and know they are good. There are many, many things that technology has teaches us. What I'm interested about is not this. What I'm interested about is all the things that suddenly happen, that technology is exposing on our human nature. So, for example, the friends here of Singa, you know, 3 blocks ago, away, when they released social games, we learned that the average gamer, social gamer, was a 43-year-old woman. Surprising, isn't it? So essentially, as we put technology in the hands of consumers, we are learning quite a lot about human nature. And we uncover things that, hey, you know, farming became a huge success. So how can we get to do more of these things? Another thing that puzzles me is when I being in front of a taxi, I still prefer to call it an Uber. Somehow because I like them to recognize me by my name, or perhaps because now even taking the car out to swipe it has become the reflection that we are being. So I always think, okay, if we do this, you know, if we are able to uncover these unmet needs, we will be in a much better possibility. The thing is, as Sam was explaining, that in order to create great things, we need to create great things in parallel. We need to drive this motivation and engagement even within the corporate environment. So creating a nice application wouldn't be enough. And this is what we need to deal with. Now, millennials. Now, millennials represent a challenge to pretty much any HR organization. For me, they are a blessing. These digital native people have been grown up in a world in which they are not only passive consumers, as I was when I was a kid, but also, as Mike said today, you know, a producer that collaborates with others and co-creates. They have also grown up in a world in which, in this, they get an answer to anything they want to know. So this, in turn, creates a sense of urgency on how their career must move. They have become feedback crazy, you know, and they also have this drives a sense of urgency on how fast their career should move, and also drives they come with blur boundaries between work and pleasure. You know, a lot of people talk about work from home. I believe we should talk more about pleasure at work. And they also have better boundaries with their hierarchies. You know, flatter organizations with people who think more and that they are all engaged is much better for us to actually be innovative. So, a couple of weeks ago, with Martin and the rest of the team, we did a tour on different offices of the company. We went to 9 cities in 4 days. And we learned a lot from speaking to the people. And they had a lot of demands. And they had such a large number of demands that actually what my idea is that they have become the most demanding consumer out there. You know, why I believe? Because in this environment of talent scarcity, talent knows that they could go anywhere else. And they are making a huge investment and they are taking a huge risk by betting on your company to actually deliver that career to happen. So, if we look at this, essentially what we need to satisfy as an organization is a wonderful digital journey, or at least a digital, you know, an experience that satisfies many of their demands. For example, during that trip, they were asking for feedback, you know. They were asking to have a clear vision of what the career path should be, and they wanted to be developing fast. They also demand transparency. There are a number of things that they want to know. And the problem is that, as it happens with your mobile carrier or your bank,
It is not
that these organizations don't want to provide a good service. The problem is that organizational structures and our human nature is also very, is very unlikely to be delivering those wonderful solutions. Now, people have the willingness to do things, but necessarily cannot be fail-proof, and they cannot be taking care of all the different things that happens. Our human nature limits us in some way. So, I want to tell you today how technology, we have made some experiments. These are some experiments that we did on. I remember on the night of the 5th anniversary, one night they said, hey, I'm going to try to line up the values, the corporate values of the company. And not only that, we would like to put it into the walls. But that day we also decided that we wanted for people to actually live those values. And so we thought an experiment. And that experiment was, I'm going to give you a solution an application that I can give you a start for thinking big if you say that if we do this or that, we will acquire IBM next year. And if you stay with me last night helping me, I'm going to give you a start for being a team player. So these are the values. And essentially, the results were very surprising. I'm going to tell you a show you a little video about that solution, but then I want to show you some results that for us were interesting. So this is the solution that we've been building.
Multiple generations working all together in a single room where talent lists for constant recognition, motivation, and innovation. Only organizations who excel at promoting teamwork, purpose, and autonomy will succeed in this environment. How should we address this new challenge in this ever-changing world? StarMedia introduces a new way to motivate and inspire teams in a social and interactive platform. Using new trends and technologies, StarMedia seeks to engage employees while embracing the new paradigms of the modern workplace. By enabling a real-time space to interact with peers and develop confidence, this collaborative and crowdsourcing tool will spread the key values of your company's culture within your network, encouraging peer recognition, sharing team successes, and enhancing spontaneity. So, who is best at recognizing values and skills better than a coworker? StarMedia. Engage and collaborate. Increase the positive impact in your organization.
I think this was an experience. I mean, when we put this to the world, people started to send stars to each other. It was like dropping the line on that spot where all the clouds were. Suddenly we said, hey, what's happening here? We are not doing anything. We are not giving monetary rewards for this. But essentially, people is trading stars like crazy. It was like Twitter when they launched it. They didn't know that it was going to be so adopted. So today, by using that, not only we place into the hands of our employees some simple to use tools, and some tools that fit right into the nature of what people is looking to do. In exchange to that, we are able to do things that typically an organization cannot do. So for example, today, in a couple of a few hours, we are able to map the connections of our employees. How do they connect to one another? Detecting the ability to, you know, making the ability to detect many, to learn many things about this. For example, we're able to identify informal leaders. So we penetrate hierarchies and geographical distributions, so we can get to know people because their peers are actually recognizing them, which is also very important in order as to do SAL, as to go and invite those people who have the extra drive. We also identify some clusters. I know it's not clear we hear the connections because of the projector, but we are able to identify disconnected clusters. We also started to play around with the data, and suddenly we discovered the connectivity between the different offices in the organization. So we are, as you can see, we are pretty well connected among all the cities. For example, I see that Medellín in Colombia doesn't have connectivity with Pune in India, or doesn't have a connectivity to Madrid. No? So there are no reasons why people connect to one another, which is something that triggers us the question of, are we really taking care of this location? We have 34 offices. So essentially, technology is allowing us to discover things that typically happens, like you are not paying attention to this. Interestingly, these kind of solutions work pretty well across different generations. So we see that, for example, on the blue line, we see people from 20 to 29 years old sending more stars to their own loop. But still, they send and recognize the 30 to 39 people. As you see, across the different ethnic groups, they are using social tools, breaking something that we would think that, no, this is something for a young generation. We are also seeing, for example, that the connectivity people in the US, in certain customer locations, they are sending 3 times more stars than what they receive. They are like asking for help. You know? Many times it's very hard to see that you have someone forgotten in a pretty large organization and technology is about comes to help in order for you to scale. Because how can you scale a people company when talent is so scarce and so demanding without having the right tools and actually able to discover all these things? Another thing that we have seen is that good rewards deliver more rewards. For example, let me mention that a global sends stars to one another, there is a 50% likelihood that that global will send a star to someone else. So starting a viral effect. Actually, when they get inspired, they also recognize 3 people. So this is very important. Once you can leverage big data within the organization, it's extremely important the experiments that you can do. And this led us to work in many other things. You know, it's like you need to become far more simpler, far more accessible with your tools in order to create, to empower this generation and at the same time get benefits. So for example, we are having now releasing a batch system, allowing people to earn badges across their career path. We can also have challenges, so anyone can challenge another one to earn a particular badge. So if you know something and we want you to give a course to the rest of the community about everything that you know, I will challenge you. And suddenly, when that happens, we will all celebrate together, which is also important. We also took some examples from somewhere like Tinder. I know that nobody used Tinder here, okay? That happens everywhere I go. But grabbing some concepts of Tinder, of how lightweight things should be, you are able to move through your work mates and suddenly rate how they are and essentially get a 360 visualization of where you are. And also drawing on some other things that we've seen working perfectly, like the endorsements from LinkedIn, we are also using that. As you can see, technology is able to unleash many things and solve many problems. We are now working, for example, on like a Netflix-like recommendation engine for projects. Because people would love to have the best projects. We are executing about 500 projects at any given moment. But simply they don't know it. They cannot discover everything that's happening there. So a lot of things to think about. Second important thing is, I want to come back here. And this brings me back to the example of Mike. Mike spoke about graph, about the Nissan graph. And it's surprising to see that we are also working on something pretty similar, but it's about knowledge. What happens? People knows and suspects that someone else on the organization might be thinking of something similar to what they are thinking. They are extremely eager to collaborate, but they are not willing to make an extra effort to do that. It's very important as the company grows, how do you make knowledge traverse? How do you know who knows what, who is working on what? Now, if we were able to crack that, we would be in a much better position to be more productive, to be more innovative, and to recognize the people by the things they are actually doing. It's very hard to get a full description of what someone knows. You typically know that if you are working in a certain position, if you are a Java developer, you are a Java developer. You know? We tend to tag people because of the position they are using right now, but there is much more to that. So, similarly to what Autodesk was doing, we started a company that uses artificial intelligence and machine learning to know who's doing what and to make those connections and allows for that collaboration to happen. We went to another source of data. We crawled Stack Overflow, the vast repository of knowledge on IT. And we also created our own knowledge graph, allowing for some terms, technical terms, to be connected to higher terms. So for example, we may know that Hadoop and MongoDB, they are both related to big data. For example, creating connections about terms. And we use those terms to create this graph that is like a brain here. And then we have an extension to the Chrome browser of our developers and also to the development tools to see what things can be done. And this is the result. When they look at something on the web, they are able to see documents related to that has been approved by the company, in addition to everything that the company has. They are also able to see who are the experts on those terms within the company, and also people who are also looking for those type of terms. They are also able to annotate. We are annotating corporate-wide some links that we believe are good, some others who are outdated, and some others that you don't need to worry about. So we are allowing for an effortless collaboration there. Interestingly, we also are able to map who's working on what and try to understand who knows what. And as a result of that, we are able to see, for example, that this developer has this certain activity, and we are able to uncover what do they know. This guy is great at Angular.js and jQuery. We are also able to find people. This allows us to find people who know certain things within the organization. Like, for example, this guy knows MongoDB. These are the guys who know it, sorted by activity. We will also add that they need to know Hadoop. And we will have the results there. But we can also ask people who have used this in the last 2 months, so they have it fresh. Additionally to this, we are able to compare what is people using less and what they are using more now. So people during the course of a lifetime as a developer, they can change what they do. And interesting, we are also able to compare two bloggers. It's very clear here, but we have seen that this guy has more Ruby, this one has more Java. There are some, they share JavaScript and Kotlin knowledge. So we are able to compare people and make the right decision for their career. We are also looking at here at how do they contribute code to a particular project. As time goes by, there are people who are contributing less, some others who are contributing more, and this is very interesting for us to understand who to go when we need to maintain some code. So this is another example of how technology can do something that people typically don't do. They don't update their resume. they don't update what they know. It is important to make it very, very easy for us to know it anyways. So for example, some things that we learned that there has been 28 bloggers asking on how to, that visited on Stack Overflow the question of how do we undo the last commit? Or 27 bloggers went to see how to remove a specific element from an array on JavaScript. These are examples that drive us to know what can, where do we need to train our people. We also can promote some knowledge. For example, there has been 90 bloggers who did a particular search exactly with the same terms. So when that happens, we are able to go there and say, okay, we need to write an article teaching them how to do this. These are some experiments that I wanted to share with you. And these are some examples of how technology and artificial intelligence can be used. And in summary, I would like to say that satisfying the overall journey requires a lot of technology. Otherwise, people will always be with high expectations who are underserved. A focus on simplicity and human-oriented rather than process-oriented is extremely important when you are working on internal tools, because those things are the ones who are going to be extremely widely adopted. Artificial intelligence, big data, mobility, Internet of Things, social, could be combined to achieve all these goals. So for example, it's now very easy for you to go and think on you know that your people is carrying a mobile phone, it's very easy to install beacons on the office. We are now thinking, for example, when we send the stars to take this and load a magic wand and say, hey, and give you a star. And I wouldn't be able to do that unless I know that you are in close proximity. So all these things are extremely important. And I believe that at the end of the day, if we are able to become a better organization, very well organized, with people who are extremely engaged, for sure we will have a very large competitive advantage. Thank you very much.